Without further ado, let's have a brief prayer over the food, and then we'll begin. Gracious, loving God, we thank you for all the blessings you give us today, all the gifts, especially the spiritual gifts that you bring to us, the depths of our souls, for learning new understandings of your scripture, of the way you still speak to us today, and the way you're continuing to work to transform our lives and the world around us. Bless us, and let's give gratitude for Dr. Fleming and the insights he shares with us this evening. In your name we pray. Amen. Well, thank you all. After he presents tonight, we'll have a Q&A session, so start thinking as he speaks about some of the questions you might have.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Chuck. I'm going to take advantage of the moment of Dr. Brewster not being here to tell you a story about him.
All right.
It was probably 15, 20 years ago he came with a group to Israel, and we had a couple of days in the desert. And we decided to have a field trip that would go to a very unusual salt cave, the southern Dead Sea, a cave that rainwater had eroded out. And it's sort of like being in a glacier. If you put your flashlight on the side, it would go through the salt as though it were ice, and it was very pretty. But anyway, there had been an unusual desert rain that caused a portion of the cave to be a bit muddy. And on the trip, I was teaching 12 Catholic priests called Merino Fathers, who were from missions, and they had a study course in Bethlehem. And they joined us on the trip. And when we got back on the bus, someone from Dr. Brewster's church came to the mic and said, "Oh, I was so grateful that we had the Merino Fathers with us, because I was kind of scared in that place. It was a little bit slippery." And Dr. Brewster came to the mic. He said, "What am I, chopped liver?" Okay, my friends. What would be the way the Greek mind would speak about what I have in my hand? And how might someone from a Middle East ancient background speak of it? I know it's plastic and stuff, but let's pretend that they are also speaking of it. In the Greek mind, appearance is important. If I told you to make 5 sentences about this, you're not going to be called on, but what kinds of things would you say about this if you had to make several sentences about it? Most of you would say something about chemistry, dimensions, color, maybe what's inside. It is speaking about it within itself. In the biblical mind, you speak about something, your relationship with it, subject in relation to object, not the object within itself. That's why we've been doing in our class, the way you speak about God is a functional relationship. What does what you're speaking about, like tonight we're going to talk about shepherds, what is the function of a sheep in relation to a shepherd, shepherd in relation to a sheep, and not a shepherd within themselves, how they look or how tall they are or what they're wearing? So the Hebrew mind would say, is it good for cold and warm? My relationship with it. How long does it last? Can I put it in my toga pocket and still ride on the camel without it breaking? You know, what does it do? The 23rd Psalm, which we're going to be talking about in a few minutes, it's not abstractly, God is a shepherd, the Lord is my shepherd. So you see, the psalmist considers him or herself to be a sheep, and the relationship of the sheep to shepherd. So it's a very practical way of looking at things around you. And we're going to now start where we left off last night with taking a few things. We'll focus more on Old Testament ones, and then tomorrow night we'll do things that relate to some of Jesus' teachings as well. So again, if you have the yellow notebook, there's still half a dozen or so left back there. You can see the page numbers here relate to the yellow notebook. Also, there's a few diagrams in the back where it says also page 112, we're referring to diagram in the back. Okay, see, I have an advancer here and an on-off switch. Okay, God is my rock and fortress. You don't ask, what does a rock look like? Or even, what is its geology or chemistry? For the biblical mind, you ask, what does a rock do? How does it function in relation to the subject? God functioned as rock and fortress. This is an aerial photograph of a famous fortress in the wilderness of Judea named Masada. Masada fortress is pronounced Matsada, and the word Masada simply means fortress. Do you see, it's a mesa that was eroded from the plateau. So it's very secure standing by itself. But can you see, if you have good eyes, there's a siege wall around the fortress. It's at the lower left, you can see it in particular, a 3 mile long wall. And the Romans made a siege ramp on the right coming up to the fortress. And these were Roman camps around the fortress because the zealots made their stronghold up there. A determined enemy, a fortress will eventually fall. It's always easier in every period to have an offense get through what seems like an impenetrable defense. And Masada did fall in 73 AD to the Romans. So for the psalmist, only God is a true fortress, an impenetrable defense. On top of Masada, it was constructed by King Herod the Great when he came to power in 37 BC. You see, he had huge storehouses. A few of those storehouses haven't been excavated. You see, it's kind of rubbly, but the ones with the deeper shadows have been excavated. Believe it or not, there were still stored goods there. In fact, it's so dry in the desert that there were date pits from a storehouse that when they planted them, they still germinated. 2,000 years, the mystery of DNA with water again, they germinate. They're waiting for the dates to be a little bit older. They hope it'll be a female date, the one that they're working on, so it can produce more dates. Usually in a date orchard, you only have female dates and one male date tree, and then you hand pollinate, because you don't want more of the males around than you need, because they don't produce grapes. A very happy male date, I should remind you, who is humming a little song. Do you want to make a date to make a date? No, I'm sorry. Okay, so rocks are also used for man-made fortress on top of this natural fortress and for strong buildings, right? Here's another view of those warehouses. But you wouldn't think of it. A mountain, a rock mountain, provides shadow. And in the desert, it's at least 10 degrees cooler. God is my rock also means God is my shadow. The old English hides my soul in the cleft of the rock. Modern English saves my life in the shadow of the rock. See, you need to ask, what do rocks do, to understand what it means for the writer to say God is my rock, God functions as rock to me. This was a group with camels. And between 11 and 2, you try not to be out in the sun and joining the mad dogs and Englishmen. You try to get in a shady part of a valley to relax. Am I doing something? Okay. Here's a stone quarry. It's kind of a dark picture. But, of course, many things are built of stone, and you square the rocks. A rectangle has six sides. You can reach the top
and the four sides. This is one of our staff pretending to be a slave. Do you see? He is stacking up some mud and is going to be pouring water in this trough around the rock. And then you stick in wood. And the wood swells and releases the rock. So the bottom you can't reach with your pickaxe. Or depending on the shape of your stone quarry, you look here. Here's a stone quarry, you see, where you're sticking in wood and then you would pour water to release the stones. So massive building stones will make a city wall, a fort, etc., for protection. You have hoisting devices. Can you tell there's a wheel at the very top? And you'd have people walk in the wheel through a series of pulleys. By the way, 500 BC, the Greeks knew every time you go around a curve with a pulley, it reduces the weight by one quarter of what it was before. It doesn't mean with four pulleys, it weighs nothing. It's always one quarter of what remains is reduced. And there's a little knob on the rock, you see, where you can hoist it up. Building, eating, massive buildings. So many things are done out of rocks. Look at these rocks. It's called dovetail, when it's like puzzle pieces, and you can slide them together to make it strong. Like if, let's say, it's a sandy or even a swampy area, you'd have these interlocked rocks, such as you see here, to make it stronger. When Paul wrote the Galatians, be stones rightly joined together. Help make one another strong. That's what we as a faith community should try to be towards one another. The word for the vocation of Joseph and his son Jesus in Greek is tekton. You probably hear in that, plate tectonics, technical. It's the word that simply means builder. When it refers to plate tectonics, it's the theory of different plates of the earth push against or side along or pull from one another, tectonic. But at least 90% of things are built out of stone. It simply means construction worker. It does not refer to the substance of which you are building. Well, in King James' day, the main building material was wood, so it got translated carpenter. But it's much safer to say construction worker. 9 out of 10 things Joseph and Jesus built would have been out of stone. Chiseling. Think of his sermons, cornerstones, foundations. It's true you also have beams for your roof with mats and then mud. Don't try to remove a piece of sawdust out of someone else's eye if you have a beam in your own. My yoke is easy. My burden is light. You could go to a big city and buy a standard yoke for an ox, or you could have Joseph and Jesus come over and measure the shoulders of your ox and make a custom ox that would fit the animal to be easier for that that animal. Jesus probably had much more assuming of a physique than we picture in church art. It became the custom as early as the 5th century A.D., to show someone was pious, you made them skinny. You made them ascetic. There's so many monks and things, you know, would eat one meal a day and look like skin and bones. So Jesus tends to look at much art like he would fall over if he sneezed. But being a construction worker, he probably had much more assuming of a body, or particularly shoulders and arms, than we would picture. This is a drawing in light of the excavation at the temple platform of how this corner and massive stairway would have looked. As they left the temple in Mark's gospel, going back to Bethany last week in Jerusalem, so one of the disciples said, have you ever seen such beautiful buildings or magnificent stones? Some of those stones are a couple hundred tons in size. Herod was a Texan and wanted you to have the biggest stones in the world at his temple platform. I was joking with Pastor Chuck that I was at a family wedding event last summer. We went to Alaska, and I saw a T-shirt in an Alaska store that had a big outline of Alaska on the front side. And the middle was a little teeny Texas size, see? And the quote said, "Isn't she cute?" Okay, anyway, sorry, that wasn't a very nice Texas quote. So many things are made out of stone. Actually, God is my rock also means God is everything to me. Because so much, even stone plates and cups and things as well. Let's look at salt a minute. Many references to salt in the Bible. Again, that's page 43, says a little something on it. We are fortunate to have a supersaturated body of water, the Dead Sea. It can hold no more salt. In fact, there's undissolved salt in it. The ability of a liquid to hold mineral salts depends on its temperature. So, for example, hot tea can absorb more sugar than iced tea. So the Dead Sea in the summer can have 33-34% salt. In the winter, maybe 32%. More of it crystallizes out when it's not as warm. But along the shores of the Dead Sea are places you can gather the salt. This is looking across a model showing you the mountains of Judah in the foreground and the Dead Sea in the distance. Do you see some salt pans there? And what you do is you allow water to flood them and then you let it just sit and evaporate. And then you fill it again and evaporate. Of course, the mineral salts stay behind. This is how the undissolved salt in the Dead Sea works. Now, some of it is what we would call Epsom salts, potassium, magnesium chlorides, but some are sodium chlorides. Do you think I should be standing a different place in terms of the speakers or something? Okay. But the shoreline, you see, it's dirty. And so what you did in the past is you would go to the market and there'd be shovels of dirt and salt in a bag. And you'd buy that and take it home. Let's go back to that picture. So the saying of Jesus, when the salt has lost its flavor, well, just a minute, salt doesn't lose its flavor. Do you understand? When the lump of dirt and salt in a bowl on your table has had all the white pieces picked out and sprinkled on your food, what remains is the dirt. So it's good to be for nothing but to be cast out in the street, they had dirt streets, and trodden underfoot. You see, the idea is you are the salt of the earth. That time it went, there was some interference on the system we noticed at lunch. So should I see if this one works? Do I need to do anything with this one? Hello? One, two. There's no red light. I tried the other way.
Oh, it's on. Testing, one, two.
Magic hand. Oh, hello, one, two, three. Okay. Some of you looked a little bit sleepy, so we put that noise on just to help you to wake up. You are the salt of the earth. Use what gives flavor to the earth. What else would salt's function be? What would ancients do with salt? Preservatives of the earth. You can salt meat and fish, right? Jerky, right? It was the main preserver of the earth. This is environmental sensitivities. We are very important. You and I should be helping to preserve the earth. You're the flavor of the earth. You can also use it for purifying. Like, for example, a newborn is washed in salt water. You are the purifiers. Remember, in the book of Revelation, purified with salt is a phrase. Okay. So many functions of salt. Let's look at a tent. Again, page 45. You will find that It's very interesting. Tents are not made out of skin like American Native American teepee tents. They're made out of weaving goat hair. From this aerial view, you can see there are two tents in a little valley. Can you barely see a flock of sheep just coming back to the encampment? Here's a little circle of a sheepfold. It's a bit darker inside. This Bedouin probably has two wives. The first wife would be in the larger tent. The Bedouin learned don't put two wives in one tent. But do you see how dark goat hair is? Black, brownish black, keeps out ultraviolet radiation. And darker hair goats live longer, pardon the pun, have more kids. And therefore, they are the predominant, quote, color of goats. And they're perfect for a tent because you're actually healthier wearing black like this woman is wearing black and living in a black tent. Not that the Bedouin know it's ultraviolet radiation being kept out, but again, predominated as being a people living longer with black. But the goat hair tent, if you look at, here's at our museum, a couple of them. The little panel on the left is a mixture of some lighter goat hair with darker goat hair as well. But the panel on the tent, if you here, you can see even in a snowy area in the high mountains, it's an image of protection. Here you're looking inside one of our tents toward a sheep fold with made of sticks. But there you can see the surface of the tent inside. At a Jewish wedding, you have a canopy, a chuppah. The new couple will be protection one with another. So you have a symbolic tent above them. Well, here you can see the Bedouin weaving the tent. You have, it's a very thick yarn that you use to weave panels of the tent, and then you stitch the long panels together. You're looking up at the ceiling of a tent with the day sky above. And you see how wide the weave is. Look at all that space. When goat hair is dry, it's very thin. And the don't have a third hand here for what I'm holding, but the warm air can rise through the weave in your tent. But as soon as it rains, it swells and becomes waterproof. Isn't that perfect? It is breathes when you need to when it's hot, but becomes waterproof. So it's not only shepherds that live in tents, coverings of patios, awnings in front of stores. Paul, Priscilla, and Aquila are tent makers in Corinth, a city of a couple hundred thousand. But there'd be many uses. There's also the Corinthian Games, which has a tent city around it every 4 years. But it's perfect. Now, this is nice. The ceiling of a tent at day looks like a starry night because the tent is almost black. And the little holes in the weave look like the stars. So in the Hebrew language, the word for a starry sky is the tent of the heavens. Because that's how it looks inside your tent in the day. And do you see what they're saying when the little kids are getting afraid of thing that goes bump in the night? Don't worry, Junior. God has just unrolled the tent of the heavens to protect you at night. Sometimes there are poorer Bedouin who use gunny sack material, discarded military tents, and aren't necessarily the dark goat hair tents. Now, from that, we're going to move now to shepherds. Perhaps one of the most common imageries in the Bible for God, what God is like. Tomorrow we'll use some images in the New Testament. The two most hands-on, hard work vocations in the past were a shepherd caring for the sheep and goats and a vine dresser in a vineyard. So God is pictured both as vine dresser, like Isaiah 5, John 15, Last Supper, and also as a shepherd. God is a good shepherd. Preparing for a book, which I hope one day to write, I was interviewing some shepherds in different countries, and I was able to get off in October, and before going, Halloween had arrived, and I knew it would be nice if someone gives some time to be able to give, like, candy to some shepherd boys. Do you see this little boy has a shepherd's rod in his hand here? I'm offering him some M&Ms and spoke with his dad about his work as a shepherd. The shepherd on the left, the bald man just now lighting a cigarette, and his colleague on the far right were shepherds at a little hut they had built up in a plateau where they would sleep at night and have several flocks of sheep. I didn't want to bring cigarettes to give them if they would give them time, but when it came time to offering him M&Ms, I felt, maybe I better not. He looked pretty tough. But it's interesting, talking to shepherds, I was doing a survey asking the same questions of every shepherd. Guess what they answered for what is most difficult for you? Being away from family and friends. Here's Mustafa. Salim, I do not know Turkish, but I had a guide helping. My favorite shepherd was Nutula. Look at his hands, are pretty tough. Here's Vega, he's showing me a stone cave sheepfold. But he was not missing his family as much. Did you know Turkey has put up cell phone towers over the entire country so that everyone, even remote areas, has access to internet? So grazing areas, there's different kinds of grazing areas. Most of the grazing areas in the Bible are the wilderness of Judea. This is a 12-mile wide wilderness between the Dead Sea and the mountains of Judah. Here you can see some dried grass from the winter rains. Do you see some oases in the Jordan Valley at the very top of the picture? Here's an encampment. There's four shepherds with tents around a central sheepfold here. The goats are just coming in from a day of grazing. There are places where it's green. By the way, those aren't obedient sheep on the right. Obedient, they are have their legs tied together for milking. So let's look at Psalm 23. Not abstractly, God is a shepherd, but the Lord is my shepherd. Just like I was saying, you're the biblical mind, a relationship of subject with object, not the object within itself. I'd like to spend some time on this with each verse for a moment. Most scholars feel Psalm 23 is a day in the life of a shepherd. It starts in the morning, what you do at noon, the afternoon when you bring the flock back to the sheepfold. Now get out of your mind a nice green rolling hills of Pennsylvania or Scotland and put in your mind where there's marginal land next to very rugged, dry deserts. Here's a shepherd. Do you see he has a donkey? By the way, the donkey just had a baby a couple of days before. But this is the older man I showed you, and he has some supplies and even a mattress on the donkey because they're going to be away for a number of weeks. They're grazing in a field that was already plowed. The sheep are eating the stubble. Okay, let's just take one verse at a time, my friends. The outline of Psalm 23 is the premise, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The word therefore is understood between the two clauses. The Lord is my shepherd, therefore I shall not want. And then the next four verses are illustrations of not being in need. And then the conclusion. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. But notice the word is makes me lie down in green pastures. Now here are some sheep in Scotland. So get that green out of your mind. Here's a green pasture in the wilderness of Judea. My goodness, that little gray-green areas there. But you have to look pretty far to find green pastures. And it's important if you're grazing in the morning that in the afternoon you might have a long journey, so the shepherd makes you rest, makes you lie down in the green pastures. Only the shepherd knows what's involved with the rest of the day. Do you see this green pasture? That's what it looks like. You see there's some greenery in here, a little bit there, some here. That's how the wilderness of Judea looks. This was a good year of rain. The northern slopes are green. They don't have the afternoon sun burning off the dewfall of the night before. Even the wilderness where it doesn't rain, there is dewfall. And so the good shepherd takes the flock to the northern slopes. Do you remember the psalm, how beautiful is Mount Zion on the sides of the north, the city of our God? But it's unusual to have that much greenery on the northern slope. A hired shepherd goes where it's easy for the shepherd to walk. A true good shepherd takes the flocks, even if it's more walking for the shepherd, to the northern slopes. Sheep can get easily distracted and be concentrating so much on getting grass to eat that they don't notice the herd has moved on or the flock has moved on. So you try to have them lie down together and rest. So here's a flock. You see they are almost all lying down. Boy, look at that green pasture. This is in Lebanon, which gets more rain. Do you see this green pasture? The shepherd's taking them under, these are goats, under a tree to have them rest. Generally, goats' social distance is a little bit more spaced out. Sheep like being real close together. Goats like being a little bit more scattered. So they're going, it feels so good to rest in this green pasture. Does that seem a little bit tight for a social distance? Even walking, a sheep likes their nose in the rear end of the sheep in front of them. I mean, you know, they're really close one to another. Here's some baby sheep. Leads me beside still waters. Why would it say still waters? A noisy stream, a gurgling stream, frightens sheep. What a good shepherd needs to do is put some rocks that would make sort of a dam so it'd be calm just behind the dam. There's some more rocks there, a place there. If sheep walk into fast-flowing water, it gets between their thick wool and they get so heavy they can drown. But if you lead them beside still water, they are timid and afraid to go, they will walk in quiet water and be able to walk out, and it rolls off like off the feathers of a duck's bath. So do you see the psalm is celebrating the sensitivity of the shepherd to the weaknesses of the sheep. The sheep is afraid to go down to that water. You cannot tell because of the bushes, but it is running pretty fast. Here's our little oasis at our museum. So we have some still waters you can see there. Canyons sometimes have in them basins where you can take a flock to drink. Here's a seminary group. We were excavating a desert monastery up there. We dig in the morning, the afternoon, we would explore the area. With Jim Fleming as their guide, they didn't necessarily fear no evil, but it's a rugged wilderness, as you can see. Isn't that a beautiful spring? We spoke about water already. The spring is gift water, water that comes to you. Here's some wild goats. They're called ibex. The alpha goat is on the right. But here we can see some still waters. More examples. And you see the shepherd has put some, whoops. We have the pointer is the same instrument as this. Dammed up here so the sheep will not be afraid to drink there. But see, that's rather fast flowing. Here's some still water right in front of a green pasture. Even a well, you haul the water and you put it in a manger, a watering or feeding trough. And that would be still water, right? To bring the water up. Look how long that rope has been hauling water from that well, eroding those burn marks are called. At our museum, you can see mangers are stone watering and feeding troughs. But that would be considered still water. At noon, you try to be near a water source to have your sheep refreshed for the journey home. You try from your encampment to go one route out, another route back, each time going slightly different so they can graze amongst the minimal greenery that you have. But you have to rest in the hottest time of the day. Can you tell this group, here's the sun line right there, but we're in the shadow of the canyon, for this little talk by some still waters. And it's so much cooler to be in the cleft of the rock, the shadow of the rock. So restore my soul means takes me to a shady area. The desert can be in the summer 120, but in the shadow, it's just a little over 100. You can really cool off in the shadow of the rock. I showed you this picture before when hides my soul, saves my life in the shadow of the rock. Here we are with a group having lunch in a cleft of the rock. So they would understand this psalm to be in the hottest time of the day. The good shepherd will take you to a shadowy area. Here's a group having a communion service in the shadow of this cliff. Now, unfortunately, you're really crowded to all get in that shadow. But then, as you know, slowly the shadow moves, and you see these little sheep over here out in the sun again. They're going to have to try to come back over here as the shadow grows this way. But it's very important that midday the flock, the herd, is not moving. By the way, you lead sheep, and they follow the shepherd. So a flock follows. You herd goats. The goats go ahead of the shepherd. And that is, if you're offered a job of having a day with a flock of sheep or a herd of goats, take the sheep. Now, to the pastors who are with us, every congregation has sheep and goats in it. All right? Some are ahead, some follow. By the way, how do you guide goats ahead of you? You have a slingshot. And you first have a little rock go just the other side of the goat to get them to turn around. If they still don't turn around, the next rock goes by their feet. And if they don't, the next rock hits the rear end to get their attention. But it's hard to guide shepherds, you know, ahead of the flock. So again, here's a nice flock resting. Distance, you can see there's also some goats, even some cattle. I think that's a repeat, I believe. If there's no good shade, the sheep have each other. And it's not good that this shepherd has not taken them over to the trees. But you see how you stick your head under a sheep standing beside you. And just anything to get a little bit of break. Now, if a person is hired by your village to go around collecting sheep from your village, you're not sure the shepherd knows them all by name and our sight, and so you will stain the back of the sheep. And you can usually tell this would be a hireling, a hired shepherd, who could easily separate this flock from another. But again, midday, you have to find some shade. He leads me in the right paths. Look how many paths are in a wilderness. Can you tell up close here? Can you tell there's all sorts of little lines horizontal where the flock goes along there? Let's look at another example. Wow. It looks like a fishnet spread across. It's been, most scholars feel that sheep were first domesticated about 15,000 B.C., so 17,000 years of sheep walking on that slope have made that network. But I want to hear you. This really applies to the 21st century. There are so many choices in life. Some paths lead to a safe area, but others may not be safe. So there are so many uncertain areas in grazing. The good shepherd helps the sheep know the right path. Do you see how there's a right path here? If you are grazing down here and walking, the shepherd needs to get you up to this path. So by the time you get to this steep area, you will be safe. Leads me into the right paths. To get up to a fortress even, do you see how a path here can go, that little break there around that steep cliff. You see how dangerous it has become here, but this area here would stay above it. Here are some goats. Now, I do not know if this shepherd wanted the goats to get off this dirt road or not, but if he didn't, he's going to have to use either hand or slingshot to toss rocks up here to get them back to the road. By the way, the shepherd is probably way back here. You're exhausted after a day with the goats in the wilderness. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadows of death. This means a steep canyon, not a rolling valley where the sun can reach the bottom, but a canyon with such sheer sides because our earth is tilted quite often. Even at noon, sun doesn't get to the bottom of a canyon, even though you have to go through a steep, dangerous canyon. This is not so bad. Here you can see a shadow side of the valley on the right, but rolling hill on the left. Here's a steeper canyon. Sometimes you have sheer canyon walls. And some are so deep that the sun never reaches the bottom. So even though I walk through a dangerous canyon, a valley, the shadows of death. Some of the steep canyons in Israel are actually, the name of the canyon is Canyon of Shadows. But with a good shepherd, you will fear no evil, even in a dangerous area. By the way, do you see a little monastery in the cliff there? There were 80 monasteries in the wilderness in the Byzantine period. Only three have survived. There's a book on this subject called The Desert, a City. Probably 5,000 monks lived in that 12-mile-wide rugged wilderness, seeking an ideal prayer relationship with God through Jesus in these desert monasteries. How's that for a dangerous valley? These were rivers in the ice ages, and that's how they were eroded. Near the edge of such a valley, a shepherd needs to be really watching them. You see, these sheep are getting a little bit too close to the edge. Again, the shepherd would toss rocks the other side of them. Here's a group walking in such a steep canyon. Now, this is the context of thy rod and thy staff comfort me. There's two instruments. Rod is a weapon. Staff is rescue. It has the crook on the end. In a very steep area, the shepherd can reach and put it under the front or back leg of a sheep and help pull them up to the next walkway, terrace. But the problem is we have predators in the wilderness. And I'll get into this in a moment. But you have an offshoot from an olive tree. It comes from the base of the trunk. Where it comes out, there's a little knob. And you cut it off, leading the knob on it. It tends to be straight. And it's about 2.5 feet long. So you can put it underneath your sash that ties your outer robe. And the knob rests, and it's a straight stick down. But if this dangerous wolf here is coming up, I can pull it out and with the smaller straight end, with the knob in, conk on the beanie, the wolf, or even toss it. It's called a netzer. The rabbis have a saying, the netzer always falls with the big end first. And they are of comfort because of predators in the wilderness. Different kinds of foxes and wolves. Of course, you have sheepfolds to help protect them at night. But here are some knobs coming up, some rods from the base of a sawed-off olive tree. Can you tell right there is a little knob there? These are under the dirt, so you don't see them. But see how straight a new offshoot for an olive tree is. Here's the shepherd, kind of dusty, but there in his belt would be a rod. There you see it hanging down. Here is a rod, but you see the shallow end above. And it covers you to be able to help with a staff to pull you up if you get isolated. You cannot see well in this picture, but the shepherd has a staff there. But if a very steep canyon, a goat can get to a place it can't turn around. And so you have to help pull it up. Here is a shepherd holding his staff. Here you can see a little bit better a staff. The top is kind of hidden, but it makes a little curve there at the top. This little kid has a staff. You can't tell very well, but the curve is over his hand. There you can see better the staff. Do you see the curve at the top? By the way, there's a sheepdog. We'll talk about them in a moment, a guard dog. But what your comfort is the rod and the staff in a dangerous place. Now, the staff, normally, the shepherd has in his hand, and every time the shepherd makes a step, you hear a little on the rock, click, click. So you can tell more where the shepherd is, the sound of the staff. But also, if you get isolated, the staff would be of comfort to help rescue you. This is my favorite mural in Israel of the Good Shepherd. Do you see the shepherd has rescued a sheep, carrying it on his shoulder? It's kind of strange because the halo for the Good Shepherd for Christ is kind of a square white halo. But I love the way The shepherd has been made with very strong legs. You could be pretty lost, and that shepherd can find you. And I also like the way the Christ Good Shepherd is young, strong, with a smile on his face. And look how the sheep is looking right at the shepherd in the eyes. I happen to speak sheep language. The sheep is saying, thanks, I needed that. There you see the face of the shepherd and the sheep. But the comfort is the rescue of a shepherd. We don't know that sometimes sheep is injured, needs to be carried back. In a few minutes, I would like to talk more about the predators in the wilderness. Well, Psalm 23 does something kind of strange. We now in the afternoon have come back to our encampment, and to make sure you catch that you are supposed to be understood as a sheep, and with the God as a good shepherd, we now switch to some human images. Instead of saying, prepares a manger in the presence of my enemies, the word table would be used. Shulcha in Hebrew, shulchan in Arabic. The Lord prepares a table in the presence of your enemies. So back in the encampment will be a sheep fold. But we've talked about it before, how that a meal is the way you forgive someone. You eat a meal together. That's why the elder brother we mentioned yesterday didn't want to eat the meal when the younger brother came home, because it would mean that he forgave him, and he hadn't forgiven him. We have an activity at our museum called Shepherd's Bread, where the kids learn to bake bread the ancient way. And then we have a meal covenant tent. And you see they're lying on camel hair rugs around a table. And they talk about the importance of a meal as a symbol for forgiveness. I got to throw this in. We had a Jewish congregation come for this, and there was a woman, their kids were coming. She said, you know, I'm rather famous in our synagogue for making challah bread for our Friday services. Would you like me to bring you one of my good recipes? Well, we're with a charcoal fire. The kids are working on little patties and putting it on hot rocks or pieces of flat metal, and sometimes it falls into the ashes and you shake it off and before you eat it. And so we said, no, fine, thanks for your offer. Well, her son was there. And as we gathered around having the meal, the kid took a bite of the bread and said, wow, this is the best bread I've ever had in my life. You should have seen her eyes roll over that one. Here they are baking the bread. It's interesting, we have adult groups wanting to do shepherd's bread as well. And you shake the cream into butter in a jar with a little stone in it. Prepares a table in the presence of my enemy means the Lord helps the psalmist have forgiveness and reconciliation meals with former enemies. Not I can eat and arrows miss me. Prepares a table in the presence of with foreign enemies. That's why it's so important to have meal subjects throughout the Bible. Remember when Jacob was cheated by Laban in Genesis, promised this daughter, gave him that daughter, promised this kind of goats, gave him that kind of goats. Finally, Jacob said, I quit. And Laban says, please eat a meal with me before you go. Show me that you forgive me for being such a rascal. So the way you forgive one another is having a meal together. We mentioned this in the story of the prodigal son. But you should keep this in mind, the two on the road to Emmaus, in the breaking of the bread, they recognize the mystery of the resurrected presence of Christ. In an atmosphere of reconciliation and forgiveness, they sense the resurrected presence of Christ. In the early church, this is an icon for Peter and Paul. the church of the circumcision is Peter, the church from uncircumcised background, Gentile background, Paul. But they always kept a greeting, a kiss on the cheek between them. And you have a concern how to have a table fellowship in the Acts 15 story. When the ossuary of James' bone box was found, the British BBC wanted to do a video about James, and so they came to use our center in Jerusalem. Have you noticed Learning Channel, Discovery Channel, these, whenever there's an ancient meal, they usually have a smoke-filled room to make it seem ancient, so they had their smoke machine going. At this point, James is telling Peter, you forgot to take off your wristwatch, so we had to film this scene again, but okay. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone recognizes my voice, I will come in and forgive, sup, dine. So the Lord helps the psalmist has reconciliation meals. Anoints my head with oil. This is actually could be either with humans. A good host will offer to anoint with oil, but also with a feverish sheep. You would put olive oil on the head. You see, if you try rubbing the hair on the skin, it doesn't feel that great. But you put a little bit of oil down, then the hair is not so irritating on the skin. But sheep are very timid animals, often are so nervous. Like our real problem nowadays is a sonic boom over the wilderness. And the whole flock could start shaking, and you have to try to calm them down. Playing a flute helps. Doing a little massage on the neck helps. My cup overflows. Again, we're back to a human image now. Oops. Here you can see a stomping vat for grapes. You see you have ropes to hang on to stomp on the grapes. And then you see the grape juice flows down into a collection vat. All right, oh, there it goes. There you see some grapes in our stomping vat. Sometimes in the summer, kids have an activity of really taking off their shoes and stomping on the grapes. And I usually make sure I bring a recently opened can of Diet Coke with me when I walk up to watch them. Oh, Dr. Jim, would you like to try some of our grape juice? Only had I not just opened this can of Diet Coke. I am so sorry, but thank you for the offer. Here's a scene, some of our staff at a Jerusalem museum showing you stomping on red grapes on the left, white grapes on the right. A collection vat for rosé at the bottom. But this is a symbol of joy. Grapes come out the dry season. They're being stomped on now, the end of the summer. Do you know at a Friday meal for Jews, the host of the table puts the cup in a saucer, then pours the wine into the cup until it overflows into the saucer. And my cup overflows is a symbol of joy, even brimming over, because grapes come out when water cisterns are drying up, right? The end of the dry season. It's a miracle plant. And then we have our conclusion. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. I didn't know what picture for that. I happened to be in the spring, this field with anemones, and a shepherd came up with his flock. But it certainly feels like goodness and mercy, such a fertile area. His flock has a mixture of sheep and goats. You see, the main sheep are following one another, where the goats are a little bit more scattered. There's a nice rainbow in the wilderness. She'll follow me all days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. May I remind you that in early years during the Judges, people lived in tents, and their worship, according to biblical tradition, was in the tabernacle. The house of the Lord was also a tent.
you get back to the encampment. Well, here's an encampment. You see there's some little caves for shelter, sheepfold areas. You're back there here as a model of how one theory is how the tabernacle may have looked. Later, it was Solomon's temple. Later, Herod's temple. But the house of the Lord is the way this psalm ends, with community. The end of the day of grazing and the end of one's life in the house of the Lord forever. Well, I hope looking at a day in the life of the shepherds would help you a bit. Here you can see the difference between sheep and goats, how they are in a line or with sheep. The joy at the end of the day. This is an artist's rendition of how the Ark of the Covenant would have looked in the Holy of Holies. If you're ever at a sheepfold late afternoon, when the flock comes back, when they catch vision of the door to the sheepfold, they stampede to get inside because there's predators outside. And I went up here after they were in and looked over the top. I don't know if it was true or not, but it looked to me like they were all going, oh, now we can relax in the sheepfold. Characteristic of sheep and goats. Your pages there are 52, 53. Sheep will cluster, huddle. Goats you'll see independently up on the hill, even lying next to one another. You try to put a large bell on a goat that is more obedient and stays closer to the shepherd to help them not stray too much. The sheep, if actually in danger, they can huddle and kick out toward a fox or a wolf by being huddled real tightly. This is a one-day-old sheep. So, again, here you can see the goats are more scattered. So God functions like a good shepherd. Look at the hand of this shepherd on that rod. It's pretty tough. Let's talk about predators. If I asked you to list some of the most dangerous jobs in antiquity, you would say shepherd because of the predators. It's not just a literary exaggeration for Jesus to say the good shepherd lays down his life for the flock. It is dangerous. Here are some jackals. In the wilderness Judea, we have lions mentioned until the 5th century AD. There's still two leopards alive in the wilderness of Judea. So we have cat predators. We have hyenas. Cave Fort Qumran, jars, they didn't have enough jars for their scrolls. They put scrolls without jars there. And some hyenas got into that and nested there and tore up the probably what had been 400 scrolls into 25,000 pieces. Now, where else are you going to get an insightful picture like this? This is hyena poop. Now, see how thorough I'm trying to be with you guys? They will completely be able, their jaws are so strong, even eat the bones. And then, of course, we have foxes and wolves. Here's a shepherd with two sheep and two sheep dogs as he rides his donkey. Now, the larger predators we lost due to the Roman games. There's a Colosseum well-preserved in Tunisia. And the combats, not only with people, but also with people and wild beasts. North Africa and the Middle East lost all of their predators between the 1st and the 3rd century AD because of the demand for the gladiatorial combat. And sometimes it's not just a Colosseum. Can you tell in this theater, there used to not be these bottom three rows, but this was the border so that you could sit and watch animal combat in the theater. Later, In the Christian period, it was decided not to be able to have these combats with gladiators and animals. But a shepherd must have a guard dog. So let me just close with this, and then we'll open for some questions. Here is a shepherd, his main guard dog there, but you see he's raising and training a younger dog here on the right. Another guard dog in the pass, in the back. Depending on the size of predators, there's three kinds of guard dogs. In Egypt and the Sinai in southern Israel, the wilderness, it is only foxes and hyenas. And you can have a saluki. It's in the greyhound family. They are normally desert colored, but they have very good ears and long legs. And they will be your guard dogs. In Canaan, you will have a kind of dog in Jordan and Israel called a Canaanite dog. Here is ours at the museum. This is one of our staff persons, and our guard dog there was named Makor. Here he is on an outing in the wilderness. You can't see him very well here, but there, Makor is there. Here's Rachel, her son Benjamin, two donkeys. When Benjamin was born, even though our guard dog was third generation city slicker, Makor would not leave Benjamin for 4 days and four nights. So he had that instinct still to protect. But further north, you need the Mastiff dog. It is huge, larger than most police dogs. This is a 6 foot high Turkish man in a town where they raised them. But these are the Mastiff. Boy, he sure fought to protect the fold. You have their packs of the huge gray wolves of Syria and Turkey. But notice, you cut the ears. It sounds cruel, but for a working dog, you don't want a wolf to be able to bite on to the ears. The American Kennel Association recognized the Mastiff as an exhibit dog, but the rule is, if it's not a working dog, you cannot cut the ears and show it. It has to be a working dog if the ears are cut. It would be disqualified if you just do it otherwise. Well, at our museum, do you see that collar? It's a dog collar. Wow. Where's a wolf going to go for? In spite of it being such a large dog, you need a spike collar and cut ears for it to survive an animal attack. And if you're a shepherd, most of the predators hunt at night. And here you are with a sheepfold, lamb chops, waiting for predators. You see how dangerous it would be. So you have to guard them at your sheepfold. You put a fence around it, sometimes with sharp sticks and thorns, to help a wolf not jump over. When we have a group of kids at the museum, I remind them how the sheepfold is a place of protection. And one of the most ugly words in the English language is exclude. And kids can feel that with clicks and stuff at school. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. I am the door. Jesus preferred it including to excluding. Safe within the sheep. Fold. Bad shepherds of Israel, some of the Sanhedrin members, kicked out from his synagogue a blind man who had been healed by God through Jesus. Do you remember in John 10? When Jesus heard he was excluded, he searched for him until he found him. We actually found the sign that has this piece joins here. This is K-N-I-M, Skinim, is the word for elders, the shepherds of Israel. The elders excluded him from his synagogue. Jesus searched for him and found him. Jesus is looking in the eyes of a man kicked out of the door of a synagogue when he searched for him and said, I am the good shepherd, I am the door. I preferred including you. We spoke before how Jesus helped protect Peter. My favorite, will close with this picture. This is a stone altar of a church in New Zealand. And look how the artist has a shepherd's staff, but look how small the artist made the sheep. It's almost like a little kitten there, the need of the good shepherd. Tomorrow we'll switch to other smaller, other farming motifs and sayings of Jesus. But it's my hope by particularly in the most common good shepherd theme of the Bible to help you realize how dangerous it is. Now you're ready for keeping watch over their flocks by night for the Christmas narrative? Okay, you guys watch from 6 until 9. You guys from 9 to 12. You two, 12 to 3. 3 to 6. But the vision and the hearing of a guard dog are better than in humans, right? And so you need to have them to help protect your flock or herd at night. Okay, how about a question for some of these images? Or we can also refer to last night as well, where we talked about some of the broader images with sea and functional images of God. How about a question that comes to any of your mind for clarification? Did it help looking at the grazing areas to see how rugged it was? Yeah. Yes, ma'am. I can repeat. Do shepherds use the rod to strike the sheep? Sometimes you'll tap a goat on the rear end or with a small pedal. But sheep are very timid, and that would be scary. There are some very bad books written about shepherds, even some that have said sometimes they'll break the leg of a sheep that's not obedient, and then it will stick closer after it's healed. That's ridiculous. But no, the rod is for the enemies. Yeah. Well, you can use a reed in punishment of a child, and that's what the rod, the word. Reed can be a rod, but rod for a shepherd is the stick with the bulb on it. It's not flexible like a reed. Another question. Yes, sir. Yep. No, they don't. Right. They need the shepherd, particularly in an area of predators, right? By the way, these guard dogs, particularly the Mastiff, they're not herding dogs. They keep on the perimeter of the flock or the herd, and if a sheep gets isolated, they go and lie down beside it. And then the shepherd can more easily find them. You see, your problem is predators like wolves try to isolate a baby or an older sheep from the rest, right? So the guard dogs know it's dangerous for a sheep to be alone. They go and lie down beside it. Yes. Is it intuitive for the dogs to lie down beside them? No. A shepherd needs to train them. You try to, of course, have a younger dog sit and follow by a larger dog that was already trained. But no, they have to be trained to be able to guard and lie beside a sheep or a goat that has strayed. Another question. Yes, please. What do the dogs eat? I'm so glad you were concerned about the dogs as well. Sometimes a shepherd will kill a predator and share the meal with the guard dog. Sometimes is that one I showed you with the shepherd who even had an older man who had a donkey carrying his mattress. He also had supplies, including dog food and stuff. But yes, the shepherd has to also be feeding the guard dogs. Yeah. Please. I was asked if there is a similar conflict with farmers who want to protect their livestock from wolves, and then in areas where there are wild wolves, others who want to be able to protect the wolves. Generally, because we have very serious distinction between enough rainfall for farming, then the wilderness, which is so barren, there's only minimal grass after a rare winter rain. So most of our predators are not in the farming areas, but in the wilderness. But even if a village has families, let's say they're on a hill in the village and some caves around it, they will have mangers and doors for sheepfolds. And someone who will be a hired person to go around and collect a few sheep from each family and take them out to the wilderness and back. And so the predators, the wolves would know where they would follow them back to the sheepfold, which is why you need to also be guarding. Either it has to be very lock secure cave door, or that your shepherd would sleep, even if it's just outside a village, with a guard dog to guard them. You probably would hear every week of some shepherd in biblical times in your area being mauled by the beasts. We have one quick story at the end now of a monk named Saba. Was a very devout person, and he started a monastery in the wilderness east of Jerusalem. It's called the Kidron Valley. And for devotions during Lent, before Easter, many people would hike from Jerusalem a few hours down this canyon that drained from Jerusalem toward the Dead Sea to Saba's cave. He preferred living in a cave, though across the canyon was a monastery for his community. And you would come down and you would sit opposite the canyon with his cave, and he would come out and give you a devotion, a reflection for the Lenten season, and then you would march back to Jerusalem. And there is a story, this comes from a scholar named Cyril of Scythopolis, who studied these monasteries in the 400s, 500s, and 600s A.D. And anyway, one time when they got there, they looked up at Saba's cave, and there was a lion lying just outside the entrance to his cave, licking his chops. Thinking, oh, what has happened to Saba? Saba came out, stood at the mouth of the cave, looked down at the lion, gave his sermon, walked back in the cave. You know, sometimes larger animals can tell if someone is not a threat. And these monks did not hunt. And so they live symbiotic relationship there. But with the loss of habitat, your largest animals were the first to go. So that's our last reference to a lion in the wilderness of Judea. Remember when David goes to Saul's tent in the story of David and Goliath? If the Lord save me from the claw of the lion and the claw of the bear, the Lord can certainly deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And being a shepherd boy, he would have had to protect his flock from some of these predators. I wanted to honor your willingness to come, even though many of you want to see the TV program. If you had another question, would you jot it down? And I'll be glad to visit with you also tomorrow at noon or the evening without a pressure on ending exactly on time. Pastor Chuck, do you have anything we should announce to them? Okay. All right. Lord bless you. See you tomorrow, hopefully. Bye.